Good morning, everybody, and welcome to this service of morning worship from St Peter and St Paul's Church in Headcorn. We've gone right round the benefice and we're starting again. So here we are. As you're probably aware, over the last few weeks, we've been celebrating some very, very special occasions. We've thought about Christ's passion and his journey to the cross. We thought about his death, and we've celebrated his resurrection. We've also remembered the way that after he rose from the dead, he came back and showed his risen body to the disciples and various other people several times until they were ready for him to go. And we rejoiced at his ascension. We also rejoiced 2 weeks ago at the remembrance of the coming of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost, the birthday of the church. And of course, last week, we remembered the fact that God isn't just one God, isn't just two gods, but three, the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, all one, but all different. It's an amazing foundation of our faith, what's been going on the last few weeks. But now, well, now we're moving into what's called ordinary time. If you look, you'll see that our altar frontal is now green. It has been white, or on Pentecost it was red. We've been changing them a lot recently. And green, as you probably know, is the symbol of growth. You think about your garden. You want the grass and the leaves to be nice and healthy and green. And that's how it is with the church at this time of year. We concentrate on keeping our church healthy, watering it, nurturing it, and helping it to grow and bear fruit. So that's why this is called ordinary time. And of course, we can't do that unless we keep remembering what's been going on during the past few weeks. We can't do that unless we keep our faith in God, who he is, what he is, and how he has behaved, and his relationship with all of humanity. We can't do that unless we continually remember that and have faith in him. So let's remember that now with our first hymn. All my hope on God is founded.
Thank you.
Well, as I said before, welcome. Welcome in the name of Christ. God's grace, mercy, and peace be with you.
And also with you.
And in a very real sense of the word, in many ways, we remember that we have come from scattered lives and places to meet with God. So let us recognise his presence with us now. As God's people, we have gathered.
Let us worship him together.
Loving God, we have come to worship you.
Help us to pray to you in faith,
to sing your praise with gratitude, and to listen to your word with eagerness, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. To listen to your word with eagerness. How good are we at doing that? How eager are we to hear God's word? How eager are we to spot, to see, and to appreciate his activity in the world? How eager are we to be the people that he wants us to be, that we were created to be? How eager are we to be true disciples and apostles of Christ? I have a funny feeling that maybe the answer is, well, sometimes we are, but often we're not. And even those times when we are eager to follow in Christ's footsteps and the footsteps of those who set up the early church, the first disciples and the first apostles, we know that sometimes we let him down. So let us now use this time to say sorry. Jesus says, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand. So let us turn away from sin and turn to the Lord, confessing our sins in penitence and in faith. Lord God, our Maker and Redeemer, this is your world and we are your people. Come among us and save us. We have willfully misused your gifts of creation. Lord, be merciful.
Forgive us our sin.
We have seen the ill treatment of others and have not gone to their aid. Lord, be merciful.
Forgive us our sin.
We have condoned evil and dishonesty and failed to strive for justice. Lord, be merciful.
Forgive us our sin.
We have heard the good news of Christ, but failed to share it with others. Lord, be merciful.
Forgive us our sin.
We have not loved you with all our heart, nor our neighbours as ourselves. Lord, be merciful.
Forgive us our sin.
And God, who loved the world so much that he sent his Son to be our Saviour, forgive us our sins and make us holy to serve him in the world through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
We're now going to hear a very special Bible reading concerning a group of quite flawed characters, but ones who went on to do some amazing things because Jesus had faith in them. And this reading is going to be brought to us by Edward and Harry from East Sutton. And they will be followed by David Trustram, who will be opening up the word to us in a short address.
Matthew, chapter 9, verse 35 to chapter 10, verse 8. The harvest is great, the labourers few. Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming all the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the labourers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out labourers into his harvest." The 12 apostles. Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease and sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector, James, son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the Cananean, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him.
These twelve Jesus sent out with the following instructions: go nowhere among these Gentiles, enter no town of Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news. Kingdom of heavens has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You receive without payment, give without payment.
If you went to a pub quiz and somebody asked you how many disciples did Jesus have, I'm sure you and most people would know the answer was 12. But if the next question was, what were the names of them? I guess that most of us would struggle maybe to get 6 or 4 of the names of the 12 disciples. So I thought today, after that Bible reading from Matthew, that we could just brush up on our knowledge of who the 12 disciples were. And when I think of them, I like to think of them in 3 groups of 4. And I think of the first group of 4 as the well-known ones, the second group of 4 as the lesser-known ones, and the final group of 4 as the unknown ones. And let's see how many of us we would have remembered if we'd been at a pub quiz. Well, the well-known ones, the first 4, were the fishermen: Peter and his brother Andrew, James and his brother John. You remember how they left their nets and their boats and everything when Jesus called them, and they became fishers of men. These 4 well-known disciples were with Jesus at several very important moments in his ministry, for example in the Garden of Gethsemane, or on the Mountain of Transfiguration, or when Jesus raised Jairus' daughter from the dead. They were a sort of inner group for him. And one of them, Peter, became the leader of the church. He was the first one to acknowledge that Jesus was the Messiah. And for that reason, Jesus called him the rock on which he would build his church. And in the Acts of the Apostles, we see St. Peter giving the first Christian sermon on the day of Pentecost. So these 4 fishermen are the really well-known disciples: Peter and Andrew, James and John. Then we come to the second group of 4, what I would call the slightly known disciples. First of all, there's Philip. We see him helping Jesus when he was feeding the crowd of 5,000 people with those 5 loaves and 2 barley, 5 loaves and the 2 fishes. Then there's Bartholomew, also known as Nathanael. Now, he was the one that Jesus promised that he would see a vision of angels ascending and descending from heaven. Then there was Matthew, the tax collector, the one whose gospel we read from today. And lastly, in this group, there was Thomas, who was famous because he doubted. he said he wouldn't believe that Jesus had risen from the dead unless he saw it for himself. And a few days later he did, and he did believe. So little glimpses of that middle group, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, and Thomas. And then there's the last group of the unknown ones, somebody called James the Less, to distinguish him from the other James. Someone called Thaddeus, also known as Jude the Obscure. Also Simon the Zealot. And lastly, Judas Iscariot. Well, we do know quite a bit about Judas Iscariot, but we don't really know why he betrayed Jesus, what was really in his heart when he did that. So that is the group of what I would call unknown disciples. How many out of 12 would you have got in the pub quiz, I wonder? It's quite hard, isn't it? And yet these men quite literally changed the world by taking out the message of Jesus and about Jesus into the wider world so that we still know it today. The thing is, they didn't want to be celebrities. They didn't want to be famous or well known. All that mattered to them was what they believed in and who they believed in. And the message about Jesus was what characterized the whole of their lives from that time forwards. That their names were forgotten didn't matter to them at all. And as we look at our lives, not many of us, I guess, will be celebrities or well-known or famous for any reason. And yet what will live on about us is what we believe, who we believe, and that will be something powerful and precious. It is our gift to the world. The easiest thing in the world is to believe in nothing. And there are many skeptics and cynics who believe in nothing and who laugh at things of the faith. So it's especially important for us at this time to be steadfast and firm, because our faith is precious and powerful as well. It is our gift to the world, even though very often the world doesn't seem to want it. Yet it is the part of us that will live on. So my message today is, let us be proud of our faith, proud of what we believe in, proud of who we believe in, our precious Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. To him be the glory, now and always. Amen.
Thank you very much indeed, Edward, Harry and David. You've all given us a lot to ponder on, and I hope that each one of us has been able to take something from that reading and from David's wonderful thoughts. I have to say that, I think I've said it before, that often I'll read a reading and something will hit me that's never hit me before. And there was something in this one. I'd never noticed in that reading before that at the beginning of the reading, the 12 are referred to as disciples. A disciple is someone who follows a teacher, someone who is learning from them. But then, as they go out, they turn into apostles. An apostle is someone who is putting that teaching into practice, someone who is carrying on the work of their teacher. And that's what they were doing then. Now, I believe that Jesus calls all of us not just to be disciples, not just to be followers of his, learning about him, but also to be his apostles, carrying on his mission and his ministry in this world, putting our learning into practice. He calls us to be just like that 12, and just like that 12, He gives us the power and the authority to do it because he knows each one of us, whether we feel we're capable of it or not. Let's remember that with our next hymn. We have a gospel to proclaim. Done. Isn't it important that we do remember every aspect of Christ's life? We shouldn't just concentrate on one aspect of it, but all of it, just like we shouldn't concentrate on one aspect of the Trinity, because it's all important. They're all important. And let's remind ourselves of that with our affirmation of faith. So let us declare our faith in God. We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. And the collect or special prayer for today. God of truth, help us to keep your law of love and to walk in the ways of wisdom, that we may find true life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And I will now ask Richard and Marilyn to lead us in our prayers.
Let us pray. We begin our prayers being mindful that we have so much to be thankful for your divine protection, the beauty of summertime in Kent, the rain after the drought, good friends, the hope and expectation of the future. Truly, God is good. For all these and so much else, we give thanks. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us. The needs around us are great. And when our Lord saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion. There are so many with sickness nigh unto death. Grant them mercy for restoration and help to all those caring in our hospitals and care homes. We pause and name them before you. Then there are so many families who have lost loved ones in recent weeks. Be with all those families who have experienced such tragic loss. Again, we bring those by name to your attention.
Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us. Now, O Lord, we remember that we have not always applied equality to all races, causing distress and unrest. Help us always to keep the commandment, love our neighbour as ourselves. Give wisdom to our nation's leaders in this regard.
Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We remember our church leaders, and particularly name Rose, our bishop. We thank you for the encouragement she has given since her arrival and pray that you will bless her ministry. May she work well with others in the church like Justin, Fiona and David. Uphold all those with responsibility in the church, great or small. Be with our vicar Fiona and our church wardens at the Suttons and Headcorn as they seek to maintain the buildings and the welfare of the people using risk assessments as we come out of lockdown. In particular, guide us through the quinquennial inspection and help those arranging the work to the stained glass windows at Headcorn. Watch over our Queen and royal family at this time. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us. We pray for our communities, that each parish will experience your blessing, particularly those families experiencing financial hardship and mental trauma in recent times. Give us the compassion and sense of caring to support these folk. Bless the work of the food banks, hostels and charities.
Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Finally, we pray for ourselves. Maybe we feel like the multitude that Jesus addressed when he called his 12 disciples. We may feel faint and broken up under the strain of the last few months, as sheep without a shepherd, of less value to the community or even our church, cut off, unempowered to serve Christ. We see the harvest is plenteous, but the labourers are few. Yet you have called us to follow you. Truly you love us, and you know that we love you despite our weakness. Freely you have given. Now we freely return our love for you.
O Lord, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you very much indeed, Marilyn and Richard. And let us now all come together and pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. You may have noticed from today's reading and from what's been said so far that actually, contrary to what a lot of people think, Jesus actually empowered the disciples to become apostles before he left this earth, before they were completely confident in the fact that they had the ability to do so. But Jesus was confident. Jesus knew what they were capable of. And having given them the power, not just to preach his name, but to do the things that he was doing, to heal the sick, to drive out demons, to bless. Now, of course, Jesus wants us to do the same. He wants us to follow him and to do the things that he did as well. I don't know whether you think you're up for doing that, whether you think you're ready to do it, but proclaiming Christ's presence in the world and building his kingdom isn't just about what we say, it's about what we do as well. And just as Christ believed that the disciples were ready when he sent them out, I think he believes that we are ready as well. So no excuses as we remember that and sing our final hymn, Will You Come and Follow Me If I But Call Your Name?
Will you come and follow me if I but call your name? Will you go where you don't know and never be the same? Will you let my love be shown? Will you let my name be known? Will you let my life be grown in you and you in me? Will you leave yourself behind if I but call your name? Will you care for cruel and kind and never be the same? Will you risk the hostile stare should your life attract or scare? Will you let me answer prayer in you and you in me? Will you let the blinded see if I but call your name? Will you set the prisoners free and never be the same? Will you kiss the leper clean and do such as this unseen? And admit to what I mean in you and you in me? Will you love the you hide if I but call your name? Will you quell the fear inside and never be the same? Will you use the faith you found to reshape the world around through my sight and touch and sound in you and you in me? Lord, your summons echoes true when you but call my name. let me turn and follow you and never be the same. In your company I'll go where your love and footsteps show. Thus I'll move and live and grow in you and you.
Well, well done, all of you. Thank you very much indeed for joining us again. Next week's service, we will be back up at St Mary's, Sutton Valence, and it's occurred to me that next week is Father's Day. I wonder what our theme will be. We'll find out next week. So our closing prayers. We go into the world to walk in God's light, to rejoice in God's love, and to reflect God's glory. And our final prayer of blessing. May God, who gives patience and encouragement, give us a spirit of unity, to live in harmony as we follow Jesus Christ, so that with one voice we may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and all those who you love and care for, now and always. And stay safe.